And you know, there is increasing pressure from lawmakers in Washington, as well as the American public, for President Obama to be more specific in the strategy for Libya. There's also increasing cost and a debate with many layers about whether the U.S. should have gone in the first place. So let's go now to Austin, Texas, to speak now to radio host Alex Jones. All right, Alex, it's day 11, and tallies have the cost thus far at about $550 million. But there are indeed people who say the Americans, NATO, they've saved my family. What do you say about all this?
Well, I mean, that's just classic propaganda. When the United Nations is going along with the butchering that happened in Rwanda back in the early 90s, you know, nobody cared. When Saddam Hussein was a U.S. puppet and brutally repressed his people and used U.S. nerve gas on the Kurds, it was a great act of patriotism. When Al-Qaeda was used to start the war with the Serbs in Kosovo, they were the great allies of freedom. And then, of course, when they were busy using Al-Qaeda and the Mujahideen to start a war with Russia, that was a great act of liberty and freedom. And now McClatchy newspapers are even reporting that the head commander of the rebels in the east of Libya was trained for decades in Virginia and is CIA. And is now commanding the Al-Qaeda forces. I mean, I even have Fox News headline, Anwar al-Awlaki, now number one in Al-Qaeda under bin Laden, secretly meets at the Pentagon and has dinner with the Secretary of the Army. I mean, that's Fox News, Associated Press. Al-Qaeda was created by the CIA, and there are a few low-level terrorists that operate on their own, but at the top, they use Al-Qaeda to attack the U.S. so they can take our liberties. And we have this new UN mandate where they ordered the president and other presidents and prime ministers with a resolution to start bombing Libya. And Obama didn't even go and consult Congress, which is the law, a declaration of war or authorization of force. So this is all part of globalism here. And there's Al-Qaeda, our gallant little ally. And I'm a bad American because I don't support Al-Qaeda. I don't support Anwar al-Awlaki running the attack at Fort Hood, admittedly, or the Christmas Day bombing, the underwear bomber, the shoe bomber, the Times Square bomber.
I think, Alex, you've brought up a lot of interesting points here. It's pretty interesting when we think back. Colonel Gaddafi is always saying that one of his things is that he's fighting Osama bin Laden. And it is interesting when the U.S. goes in and fights against Gaddafi. Inevitably, there's going to be some sharing of sides and sharing of duties with people who might have otherwise been our enemies. You also brought up the fact that, you know, the U.S. sometimes goes in places and sometimes doesn't. A lot of people have been making this criticism. Last night, Alex, we heard from President Obama making the case for Libya. He was defending his decision. The president also responded to these criticisms of people who have argued that there are many places in the world, Sudan, Yemen, Bahrain, where innocent civilians are threatened by brutal dictators. If we go into Libya, shouldn't we go there as well? Here's what he said.
It's true that America cannot use our military wherever repression occurs. And given the costs and risks of intervention, we must always measure our interests against the need for action. But that cannot be an argument for never acting on behalf of what's right.
So what do you think, Alex? I mean, are you saying that the U.S. should never act?
I mean, this is ridiculous. It's come out that British Special Forces, U.S. Special Forces were there before this began. Just like in Egypt, they fly al-Baradei in, and both of the quote, liberation groups are headed up by Western-funded people in Egypt. Mubarak says he won't stand down when the U.S. ordered him to, and then magically he has a stroke and is never seen again. That's one of their former dictators like Saddam that they propped up. I mean, this is ridiculous. The West is setting a precedent through the UN that they can fund rebels to start wars against regimes not favorable to the globalist system, and then the West will come in and bombard them. We've now seen Senator Lieberman and others calling for no-fly zone and kinetic military action, which means bombing, with the new Orwellian term, against Syria. And this is about AFRICOR later moving into Sudan, later moving into Somalia, later moving into the entire continent of Africa. This is part of full-spectrum dominance, and this is the beginning of a new front. And imagine if Hitler would have been smart like the people that run our country, and if he would have hired rebels and trained them in Berlin, just like the head of the rebels was trained in Virginia. And then you go give them weapons and you bring Al-Qaeda in out of the ally Saudi Arabia. And then they start attacking and shooting and killing and have their own jets and tanks. And they're called protesters. And then another older line dictator, who quite frankly isn't as bad as Al-Qaeda, he stands up to them. And so then you go in and bombard them and say you can't call it a war. It's kinetic military action. And they've got Marine Corps troop ships, British Marine ships. But they're saying this won't be an invasion. It's a humanitarian force.
Well,
so,
I think
so the new way.
I think, Alex, it's an interesting point that you bring up. The fact that we're going into this country, and a lot of Americans and a lot of, you know, members of the U.S. government, even people with expertise in this area, don't exactly know who the rebels are. And I want to play this for you. This is a soundbite from Senator Rand Paul, excuse me, about what he has to say about this, and I'll have you respond.
The problem with sending U.S. military to help rebels in Libya or anywhere else is that we are taking sides in a conflict and on behalf of a people whom we know nothing about. When or if there is regime change in Libya, what kind of leadership exactly will replace Gaddafi? Who are the Libyan rebels exactly?
Who are the Libyan rebels exactly? I know that you've spoken about Senator Rand Paul on your show before. What do you think? Do you think he has a point?
Well, he's absolutely right. Look, geopolitically, if you break down what's even buried in the mainstream press, it's admitted. There are a lot of angry people who don't like the 42-year rule of Gaddafi, and they have beefs. But the U.S. and NATO got the ball rolling on record by inserting rebel commanders to command hardcore Sunni radicals who want to overthrow secular Arab and North African countries. So it is Al-Qaeda. They started the ball rolling, just like they started the attacks on Serbia, the attacks on Russia's underbelly in 1979. Zbigniew Brzezinski brags about this. So yes, there are some real people who didn't like Hosni Mubarak in Egypt, and some real people who were independent, a lot of different groups that didn't like Gaddafi. I don't like Gaddafi. I mean, I don't like tyrants, but the fact is this has nothing to do with humanitarianism. It's about a beachhead in Africa, destabilizing the Middle East, and the secret army brigades of Al-Qaeda, the sword of the New World Order, is being used yet again. They use them against America to take our liberties. They use them against Russia to suck Russia into a war to bleed them. They use them against the
Serbs.
All right,
Alex, let me get in here real quick. We're running out of time, and I have you here, so I really want to ask you this. Certainly, over the last few months, especially in light of your friendship with Charlie Sheen, you've been getting some media attention. Several magazines have done profiles on you, from Rolling Stone to this one in New York Magazine. This article says, a strange man is following you, shouting about mind control, assassins, the 9/11 conspiracy, and the Bilderberg Group. Radio host Alex Jones has cornered the bipartisan paranoia market. And Alex, kind of a frightening photo there. You're called strange, a conspiracy theorist, and more. Your reaction, I mean, do you think they captured the essence of Alex in this article?
No, it's a complete, sophomoric, classical, cliched piece. And I even gave them the photo they wanted. I said, let me show the New World Order my war face, and then I'm 110%. But to be clear, New York Magazine had already been here to interview me before the Charlie Sheen thing. So had the Rolling Stone. It's just that they then grafted a little bit of that into the story. Charlie's my friend. He got back on drugs. I went out there to try to help him, stay clean, sober. And then I had him on my show to talk about how he was sober. And then he kind of went off the rails because he was angry at his bosses at Warner Brothers and CBS that day. And that was not where I intended that to go. Quite frankly, in some respects, it's kind of overshadowed some of my other important work that we do. You know, I first interviewed Charlie Sheen on my syndicated radio show because he contacted me and wanted to talk about 9/11 truth.
I think, Alex, it's a good thing, though, that you're getting a lot of, press out there. As they say, no press is bad press, and certainly your message is getting out there. Alex Jones, radio host of The Alex Jones Show.
Thanks for having me.